it's my honor to introduce Miguel Nicolelis. Professor Nicolelis is a professor at Duke University and the founder of the Walk Again Project, which is a consortium dedicated to assisting the severely paralyzed regain mobility. Dr. Nicolelis's exoskeleton actually allowed a paraplegic to kick off the World Cup a few years ago. His pioneering brain-computer interface studies have become extremely influential since they offer new potential therapies for patients suffering from severe levels of paralysis, as well as Parkinson's disease and epilepsy. Welcome, Miguel Nicolelis.
Thank you. Well, first of all, thank you very much, the organizers, for this invitation. It's a great pleasure to be here. I thought for a moment I'd change my entire talk to just to answer the previous talk, but I'll try to do that the last 30 seconds because I have a different view of all this, because I don't believe the human brain is a computer at all. We are not made of information only, and we are not algorithmic run. So we'll never be outrun by a digital machine or a Turing machine. So, but that's a completely different discussion. What I want to show you is what has happened in the last 20 years in our attempts to actually link brains to machines. Originally trying to understand how brain circuits operate. You know, this was a crazy idea that nobody believed. Tom Himso is here somewhere. He may remember how reviewers at NIH received this idea 20 years ago. It was a big no. But what I want to show you is that it actually happened and is multiplying its applications and the way we actually see the brain, but it also bringing to the table a series of new therapies for diseases that, as a physician, when I went to medical school, people thought, you know, you want to be a neurologist, forget about it. You're never going to treat anybody. You're going to make great diagnosis, but you're never going to do anything. Well, I gave up and to be a neuroscientist after medical school, and I realized that I'm coming back. Because I started in this field 30 years ago by developing a new technique to record electrical brainstorms produced by hundreds of brain cells in behaving animals. That was the big deal in the 90s, to get brain recordings from rats that are moving around or monkeys that can do things, and it was a big technological challenge. As we progress, I spent 10 years of my career studying neurodynamics and how the brain self-organizes itself according to the context, different changes in environment, social interactions, and with John Chapin, my former postdoctoral mentor, we realized that we had to create a new paradigm to come, to bring all these ideas, to the forefront. Because we truly believed that the brain was a democracy, that you needed populations of neurons to enact behavior, not a single neuron. A single neuron means nothing in a universe of 100 billion cells. It's like one star in the universe above our heads. It's the same kind of, meaningless contribution. But if you have populations of neurons, you can do lots of things. So John and I created this term, brain-machine interface, and published the first paper that I'm going to show you in a moment. And from there on, besides applying this, I don't know why this light is a little fuzzy, but besides applying this to studying the brain, we have been introducing a variety of new techniques and a variety of new therapies that I'm going to show to you. This is the original concept of a brain-machine interface. You basically have to have a functioning brain, and you use implants or non-invasive technology to record electrical brain activity in real time. You send this to computers to decode messages that you can decode. You cannot decode everything using digital language, but you can decode some movements, for instance. And that was a big surprise. Using linear algorithms, which is an even bigger surprise. And then you can send these digital commands to a variety of devices, electronic, virtual, mechanical. I'll show you a variety. And then control them and make them send feedback to the user, to the subject that is controlling that directly just by thinking. Well, that started with some experiments, for instance, monkeys. I'm going to show you the classic first experiment in monkeys, in which a monkey was trained first to use a joystick to move a cursor. And suddenly, to his surprise or her surprise, we removed the joystick, and we implied to the monkey that to continue to receive the juice that he was getting by completing the task correctly, he had just to think, not to move a muscle in the body. And to our shock, these monkeys got it. They, you know, and the first thing I learned is monkeys will do anything for you if you give them oranges. So if you have a primate at home, oranges may do it. So I don't know what is going on because it was working and we tested, but it's all dark and strange now. But I, you know, I don't know if you see a cursor going on there and a computer screen. Maybe the lights in the front will help. So what you see is a monkey is using a joystick in the bottom trying to correct. Do you know what is going on? Do you have an idea why the image has? Because we tested before and it was working so well, so I don't know what is going on. But you have a monkey here using a joystick to control that cursor to get inside of a target. And the target is basically when the cursor gets in there, the monkey gets a drop of orange juice. So as the monkey is doing that, we are recording 100 cells in the brain, sending these electrical signals to a computer that is extracting the motor information through mathematical models that you don't care about. And we are transforming this in digital commands that go to a robotic device that is 20 meters from the monkey, and the robotic hand is controlling the cursor, okay? So, but the interesting thing at this point, the monkey is using the joystick. In the next slide, which I don't know what is going on, but the joystick is gone. You see that there's no movement, there's no joystick, there's no hand movement. And now the game is happening, and the monkey is playing the game and getting the cursor in there just by imagining the trajectory of the hand that it has to be used to actually play the game, okay? And we realized that after a few days of training, monkeys simply relax the entire body, and they realize that they can get this free lunch, literally, without moving any muscle, just by imagining the trajectories, and our algorithms are able to decode and make this happen. Well, this was in 2003. Certainly something happened. Is there any chance you can go back to the direct connection so I can have the images? Otherwise, it's going to be a nightmare to give this talk, because everything is... Yeah. Can you switch to the HDMI direct? Oh, it's coming back. Somewhat. Well, this is, you know, 20 years later, this is the newest technology of implants that we can make in monkeys. This is, you can implant these days thousands of microfilaments. They are half the diameter of a hair in different areas of the brain simultaneously. And you can basically then get these things fixed in the head. You can protect these implants. They're in the width of the bone. And you can basically live for years. Our latest monkey has been recorded for 9 years. We just completed 8.5, actually, years of continuous recordings of hundreds. And now the latest, these are the brain images. It's very difficult because everything is... Yeah, I mean, can we go directly to the cable there? Because it's impossible for me to give a talk that is totally, you know, destroyed. I can move my hands, but. So these are waveforms in recorded simultaneously. And this is a graph just showing the longevity of these recordings. This was the big challenge we all had in this field. And this monkey that I mentioned to you, that was right there, in 2009 was implanted, and end of 2008, beginning of 2009, and we are still recording from the same monkey and obtaining viable neuronal data that allows us to actually control a variety of devices. In fact, we joke in the lab that this pair of monkeys, this and another one, have a better CV than any graduate student postdoc ever in the lab because they have been in Nature science papers, you know, for more than a decade. Yeah, that's what I'm looking for. Thank you very much. No. Yes, thank you. So these are waveforms that you recorded over these years, and that makes this a long-term value. It's almost a decade, which for me was the goal when we started working with monkeys many years ago. So this is our record, recorded about 2,000 neurons, and we just implanted a monkey with close to 5,000 microfilaments. So we are going to get close to 10,000 neurons recorded simultaneously very soon because we can record 2 neurons per microfilament implanted in different parts of the brain. So as time went by, you saw the monkey just playing the little video game. I can show you later if you want to show the beautiful historical image without moving. But now with hundreds of neurons simultaneously, you can start doing things much more interesting. For instance, you can teach monkeys to drive electronic wheelchairs in your lab just by thinking. So people talk about driverless cars. I think we have gone a step forward because you can drive your car just by thinking. And so this is the first experiment in which this was demonstrated. And you're going to see first from the top of the lab, there are three random positions that we place the monkey, and the monkey has to drive to grab grapes that we drop. And when the monkey sees the grapes, it basically has to create a trajectory de novo to drive the wheelchair to get those grapes. And as you can see from the front, and a different camera view, the monkey doesn't really move until it gets close to the grape dispenser and reach for it. So it's just imagining the velocity, the two vectors of velocity that it has to create, and driving there all wirelessly. So we have now a 1,000-channel wireless interface that can get these signals out and make this driving happen. So you can imagine that when we saw that, John Chapin and I, in the early 2000s, we suggested that this could be more than just a preparation to study the brain, that we could use this to rehabilitate people, for instance, with spinal cord injuries, that have lost the connection between the higher motor centers in the cortex to the muscles in the legs. So what we proposed, and at that time, lots of people laughed at us, but we proposed in 2002 that we would be able to create a bypass from the brain to the body using brain signals, decode them computationally, and send this to a robotic device, better than the ones we saw before, that actually the patient would wear and the patient would control directly with his or her mind while getting tactile feedback from the joints and the surface of the feet. That was what we imagined there. And about 6 years ago, it became reality when we created the Walk Again Consortium. And we got lucky that in a given moment, 2007, Brazil was awarded the World Cup, the Soccer World Cup, the Super Bowl just happened, but it's the biggest sports event in the world, about 2 billion people watching that thing around the world. And Brazil was looking for something more than just dancing in the typical opening ceremony. And I suggested at that time to the president of Brazil, why not have a scientific demonstration? Having for the first time a T4 mid-chest paraplegic athlete deliver the opening kickoff of the World Cup using a brain control exoskeleton. They all look at me like I had landed from, Mars. But they said yes. It was the best peer review I ever went through because it was immediate, signed, done. The check came, and we had to do it. So I had to start calling all my friends around the world. It turned out that I have a lot of friends. And they all came to Brazil. And actually, we created the first distributed neuroscience lab in history. We had labs around all time zones in the world. Not all, but most. So by the time our friends in California were finishing here, we are picking up in Brazil. By the time we were finishing, guys in Germany, France, and Switzerland were taking over. By the time they were finishing, people in Asia were, and we went for 18 months. Not even Carnival we celebrate in Brazil, which is, the pinnacle of working for your country for free. And this is it. This was the first version. Not celebrating Carnival in Brazil is like, a sin. And this is the first hydraulic 12 degree of freedom exoskeleton that can be controlled directly by brain activity and provide feedback to subjects. But we had to train these subjects. We selected a group of 8 chronic paraplegics. They had had lesions, from something 3 to 13 years with no improvement whatsoever, complete lesions, no movement, no sensation, and no visceral function, which is very critical, below the level of the lesion. And when we look at their brains, we realize what we had seen in animals before, but we got confirmation that if you stay paraplegic or paralyzed for that long, your brain literally forgets what is to have legs and what is to walk. The program is gone. If you record the brain and you ask, imagine that you're going to walk now as you used to, there is nothing, no change. So we had to retrain and reintroduce the concept of having legs. And we opted to do this in a multi-step protocol that is started with a virtual reality training. And in this virtual reality training, the patients go to an immersive virtual reality environment, and they use their brain activity to control a soccer player walking in a soccer field. And as they move this player with their brain activity, they get visual and tactile feedback coming. This is the exo foot with sensors, but we created virtual streams of tactile feedback from the foot of this virtual player so the guys and ladies could get a feeling for touching ground. So this is the haptic display. It gets the signals from the feet of the exo or the virtual player and delivers this with micro vibrating elements on the skin of the arm. And we created for the first time, we induced a phantom limb illusion. All patients had the feeling that they were walking by themselves, even though they were paralyzed. They're either sitting or they're in the exo being carried by the machine. They nevertheless reported to us that they were having phantoms, very rich phantoms. And this was key for what you're going to see. So this is one of our patients learning to use the virtual reality system. She's actually searching with her hands for the best tactile feedback parameters to experience in walking on grass, or walking on sand, or walking on hot asphalt on a street in São Paulo. And we discovered that for six of these eight patients, parameters that allowed them to, in 86% of the time, differentiate from these three textures just by using the virtual reality feedback. So she's having, right now, a phantom limb sensation. And she reports after the training what she felt. And this is one of our patients. The first day he actually implemented all this. This is all non-invasive, by the way. We opted to use EEG. We didn't want to implant anybody for that. And we discovered that EEG is enough for generating the neural signals that we need for locomotion. For doing this is not enough. But for walking a sinusoidal pattern is more than enough. So he's wearing an EEG cap with a helmet for protection. He's controlling you're going to see the exo. But more important, he's feeling it. He's receiving tactile feedback every time he touches the ground. And in Portuguese, he's actually telling us, as he walks for the first time in almost a decade, what is the sensation? What is the feeling? And we had laptops, iPads all over this perimeter of this room broadcasting this to all the labs. Even the Swiss cried this day because it was really too much for all of us. Because this guy is basically telling us my leg is flexing and X speed is about to touch the ground because he's getting all that feedback in his arms. And his brain is creating a new image, a new sense of self, a new body image. Well, I cannot show you the actual kick of the World Cup because FIFA wanted to sell the rights to us. And we are, you know, scientists. We don't have money and we don't negotiate with gangsters. So. They had all the Swiss guys, big ones, from the Swiss Guard in the Vatican, I assume, searching us to see if we had cell phones to tape the kick in the ground. We did 57 kicks on the pitch, and Juliano got 56 correct in different locations, in different parts, much better than the Brazilian center forward at that World Cup. But we couldn't tape anything. But you're in Brazil, there are some neuroscientists that were born there, and you learn since you're a little kid how to hide cell phones in places that a Swiss cannot never imagine, right? So you're going to see is an illegal footage that nobody knows who got it. The moment we're in the ramp, there are 75,000 screaming fans on the stadium. We are about to go into the ramp, into our location to do the real thing. But Juliano, who is a T4, as I said, complete paraplegic from that level down, looked at me and said, you know, I need to do one more. You know, this is a lot. 1.2 billion people saw that happening, and we had one shot. We had 29 seconds, because that's how much FIFA allocated to this thing, because we are not paying anything for the time, and apparently time is a lot of money. And Juliano asked to do one thing. So you're going to see the last rehearsal with an illegal cell phone sneak into the field. And we had lights to illustrate what it means to have a brain-machine interface working. So when you see the blue lights blinking, it's because the exo is on. And Juliano can rest his arms on the armrest. And the system is ready to take his brain activity. And it's already providing tactile feedback, so he knows that he's standing on the ground. When there's a green and yellow flow coming from the head down, you are going to basically see the command that Juliano created is being translated into digital language, sent into the electrical motors that activate the hydraulic actuators so this kick can happen. It's very quick. But so that's what it happened. Giuliano is taking the decision now. He's correcting his body, and he makes the final goal, and he kicks the ball. And the most amazing thing, I was behind him, 2 meters behind him, with 20 people representing the different countries that were part of this. He starts screaming like he scored a goal, but he screamed something that I never expected. He was screaming, "I felt the ball." For him, feeling the contact and the impact was more meaningful than the actual movement, because his brain was already taking for granted that that movement was going to happen. But he didn't expect the surprise that we made by putting sensors on the front of the feet so he could actually feel the contact with the ball. Well, we thought that this was the thing, because this was what people believed brain-machine interfaces could do, restore mobility. That was what we dreamed for almost 20 years. But we had a surprise. A month later, we took all these guys after the World Cup. We took these guys back to the lab, and we start doing our routine neurological examination, because that's part of the protocol. But for 20 years, or not 20, 13, 14, for these patients, the neurological exam was always the same, nothing below the level of the lesion. Well, we put these guys into the routine. It takes 2 weeks to do all these things. And all of a sudden, you see in the top part, these guys report an increase in sensitivity of 5 dermatomes, which is about this, below the level of the lesion. So Giuliano was a T4 when he came to talk to us, and he had been for a decade. Suddenly he was a T11. He was feeling 7 segments more of his body. That was kind of strange. In fact, if you look at the entire progression of this cohort for 30 months or so, 28 months or so, the blue line shows the increase in tactile sensitivity that they gained by continuously training with the system is now up to 12 dermatomes on average. Giuliano is now a T12, so he's feeling all the way here, down here, okay? Well, we thought, well, if sensory has improved, why not test everything else? And we start testing his motor skills and the motor skills of everybody. And suddenly, my thing just died, but suddenly we start seeing muscle contractions, voluntary muscle contractions. When we ask them, you can see on the top, I'm asking move left, move right leg, and all of a sudden I see contractions in the muscles. So I'm going to show you what it means 12 months after the training started, what this thing means. This is a woman, 11 years paralyzed, T11. Look what she can do now, 12 months into the training. She's basically moving her own leg. No exoskeleton, no brain machine interface used for this. This is a legit voluntary movement across joints. She's moving the hip, the knee, all the way to the ankle, okay? This is 13 months. Look what happened 28 months later. I asked the same patient, do exactly what you did a year ago, but try to go as far as you can. So she starts with the right leg, as we expected. She's doing it, but suddenly she said, I can do better. She starts moving the left leg. And long and behold, we move her back to see if this was just by chance. We spend an hour doing this, and she was walking forward by her own means. So she was recovering control, voluntary motor control of muscles below the level of the lesion all the way to the ankle, okay? This is another patient, another woman, and I always like to talk about her because she had a horrible lesion. And you're going to see the movements of her legs, which were stunning to all of us after 12 years of a T11 lesion. But more important, she, in addition to the movements and sensitivity, she was the first one to report recovery of visceral function. And that was because she became pregnant. She became pregnant because for the first time in 12 years, she could feel her periods. And she made a decision, because she regained perineal sensitivity, to have a baby. And she had the pregnancy and felt the baby and felt the contractions, recover bladder control, recover intestinal control. And when we saw that, we started going after the other patients, and now they all have recovered some degree, primarily of bladder control, secondary intestinal control, which are vital for an improvement of quality of life for these patients, because now they can get out to the world and drive and get a job and improve the self-image of themselves. They don't need to wear diapers anymore, and this makes a big deal. So they start recovering from top to bottom functions that were below the level of the spinal cord. And there is an American classification for spinal cord injury that is all known all over the world. It's called ASIA. All our patients were complete spinal cord injuries when we started. So there, seven of them were ASIA A, which is the worst possible. And one was ASIA B because he had some sensitivity. So now, after 28 months, all eight have been promoted to partial paraplegia, which is ASIA C. And two of the patients are ASIA B. They were 6 months ago, but we are already seeing signs they are about to make the shift to ASIA C. So each one you can see takes his or her own time because the lesions are different. The lesions are at different levels. And what we discover is through a study that had been forgotten for decades, made in Australia, the largest follow-up of patients who had 1,200 cases of patients with spinal cord injury who died of natural causes and had the spinal cord analyzed afterwards. What the pathologists in Australia found is in the 60% of the cases of ASIA A, where you don't see any movement, any sensitivity, or any visceral function, 60% of them still have some nerves surviving the original lesion. It can go from 2 to 10% of the spinal cord is still connected, but apparently that spinal cord goes quiet because you become paraplegic, you sit in a chair, or you lay in bed, you're not imagining any more movements, you're not doing any movements, so the spinal cord is not getting feedback, so you don't move, so the whole system shut down. So our hypothesis right now is that by doing this virtual training while these patients are walking in devices in upright position, we are rekindling the brain to actually use whatever is left to reroute motor commands down to the spinal cord. Well, you would think that this is just a miracle that happens once in a lifetime. But you know, about 80 years ago, we published this paper suggesting that brain-machine interfaces could be affected in another major neurological disease that when I was growing up as a physician, I told, forget about it, nothing would happen. My grandfather died of it. It's Parkinson's disease. Well, to make a very long story very, very short, when I look at the records of recordings of brain activity in animals that had Parkinson's models of Parkinson's disease, I actually look at the records and say, look, this is epilepsy. This is not Parkinson's. And my students said, no, these are Parkinsonian mice or Parkinsonian monkeys. I said, no. From a neurophysiological point of view, if you see those red spots that you see in the upper graph, that's epilepsy. I was an epilepsy expert when I was a graduate student. So let's treat Parkinson's disease as epilepsy. They thought I had lost all my marbles. And I said, and by the way, let's not use any pharmacological agent for epilepsy. Let's actually use my concept of disrupting epileptic seizures using the spinal cord as a place to send the burst of electrical activity that just desynchronizes neurons. Let's think that the brain is a dynamic machine. This dynamic machine has gone bonkers. Neurons are all firing together. That's the reason you shake when you have Parkinson's. Let's send a signal that resets the system. At that point, they wanted to fire me from my own lab, but we did. And it turned out that it worked in mice, it worked in rats, it worked in monkeys. There are now 60 patients around the world who have tried it, and it works. And I'm going to show you the latest because it's the most beautiful one. This is a study done in my alma mater, University of São Paulo, Brazil, by a neurosurgery group who actually follow all our instructions of putting, because this is a 45-minute procedure. You put this on the surface of the spinal cord. You don't even open the spinal cord. You open the skin, you move the muscles, you insert this under the bone, and you leave it. And then next day you come, the patient comes back, you basically get the parameters correct because this flat stimulator is hugging the spinal cord at the cervical thoracic transition, that's the ideal place, and is delivering high frequency electrical stimulation like the famous deep brain stimulation procedure that costs a fortune. It has to get inside your brain about 10 centimeters and you know, it has a 2% chance of death on the table because it's pretty deep that you have to go. Well, let me show you what a 10K, 45-minute procedure can do for patients who are terminal Parkinsonians and are frozen at this point. They basically cannot move. They have a locomotion issue. This is a woman that is in very serious conditions on the left without the system on, just a DBS on, because they all have DBS. This is her when we turn on the spinal cord stimulator. The difference is brutal. You know, in this test, it would take 3 minutes and 34 seconds to go in the little distance. She can do it in 17 seconds later. This is a 20-meter test, which is very, very rough on them, just to stand up and to walk. And you can see that she's walking. It's almost like you had a frozen system that now is unfrozen. You actually, and we know now that we disrupt those seizures. We saw in animals that when you give this stimulation, those frequencies that you saw disappear, those bursts of neuronal firing. I have a couple more patients. See if I have time for this. I do. So you're going to see now a case that for me is like the shock of my amateur neurological career. As a neuroscientist, I never expected to see this. That's the guy there, and he's ready to go play soccer, you know. Again, this is a patient that was not responding to dopamine replacement therapy anymore. DBS has no effect after 8 years. He has a serious frozen problem, or freezing, I'm sorry, problem with the locomotion, and the spinal cord stimulation got him out. It just came out, this paper in Movement Disorders, and we just wrote a review that is coming out in the next couple months to explain what is happening, because now people realize that this is for real. You know, that it took 8 years because there's a big, big investment in deep brain stimulation, and this is something that could be done by, you know, as I said, an outpatient clinic. But in Europe, in Asia, and in South America, neurosurgeons are already implementing this technology, and it's going to come, I'm sure. But I told you so far about what you would expect. Single brain, computers, decoding movements, sending back to robots. You know, this is what 99% would expect. Let me spend the last 10 minutes or 15 minutes showing you what you never expect. For instance, a brain net. A few years ago, I started wondering, while this concept that we created, brain-machine interface, is too conservative because it's always talking about a single brain. Could we merge brains? Could we have a cooperation of multiple brains to actually form a single brain, merge brain activity coming from multiple users that are basically convergent to a system that merges this as if it was a single brain, okay? And we created this first in rats and monkeys. I'm going to show you the monkey study first. So these are two monkeys who, to get the juice that you saw Aurora, the first monkey had to get with playing the game, now is a more complicated game to get that orange juice that they like. One monkey, this is the first two-dimensional, we did three-dimensional, you're going to see in a moment, but in a two-dimensional game, the x-axis of the virtual arm is controlled by the brain activity of one monkey. The y-axis is controlled by a second monkey. And unless these brains synchronize at a 10 millisecond resolution, nobody drinks juice, which is a catastrophe in monkey planet. So what you're seeing here is two naive animals. They don't know that they exist. They don't know that they are playing this game with another family member. That was good, because families have problems. And what you see is monkey on the left controlling one axis, monkey on the right controlling the other axis, and the arm is a virtual arm, a virtual monkey arm, is going to the center of the target, and they're drinking juice. And as you do that, you realize that the brains start out of phase, nothing happens, and suddenly these brains synchronize. The computer is just gathering the data from the two brains and sending it to an algorithm. But the two outcomes, X and Y, have to synchronize. Otherwise, the movement is crazy and nothing is going to be done on purpose or voluntarily. And they actually learn to play this game and they actually accomplish the task. We have done many tasks. I'm going to show you the first three-dimensional task, in which you have three monkeys, and this is much more complicated. Monkey one has to imagine X and Y. Monkey two has to imagine Y and Z, and monkey three has to imagine X and Z. The black ball is the virtual arm wrist that has to cross the sphere in the center for the monkeys to get reward. What you see in red, green, and blue is the two-dimensional outcome of each monkey trying to cohere so they can get this game together. So this is what I love this animation because it shows the dynamics of a brain net. So the three brains don't need it to get right all the time. Two of the brains have to get right all the time for the black box to go inside of the sphere. And that's exactly what happens. In some trials, you may see in a moment, one of the brains take a nap because he had so much juice that he's getting off the... The other two brains have learned to interact so well that they compensate. And we did this game in a way that if two monkeys synchronize, they can get it eventually to the target. So what you're seeing is basically the cooperation of a brain net and getting these things to operate a brain-machine interface with multiple users simultaneously. But it doesn't need to be like that. It doesn't need to be two monkeys or three monkeys that have no idea that they exist. And you don't understand in a moment why we went to this paradigm in which you have two monkeys in the same room, each one sitting on their wheelchairs. You just saw one monkey driving a wheelchair just by thinking, but you know, we can have as many monkeys as we want. It's all wireless. What you're going to see here is a cooperation task where the two monkeys have to make sure that, in this case, this guy who is the driver in this test reaches the pod and collect the grapes down there, because if he does, both get orange juice. What you see there is an observer. It's like one of you watching opera. It's a guy who is there, he's thinking about the same task, but he's just observing the other monkey go to get the grapes, okay? And they do. The reason I want to show you this is because as this monkey is driving to get the grapes and the others observing, we learn many, many things. First of all, if we combine the two brains, if we merge the two brains, we get the best driving. You're going to see in a moment why. Because the observer is projecting in his mind the vectors that are needed to get to the pod at the same time that the driver is doing, okay? And the amazing part is when you put these brains aligned, what you see is that they're synchronized. The observer's brain and the driver's brain are in synchrony with a 10 millisecond resolution. It's not 100% because if you're 100%, it's epilepsy. But is it a level that makes them create a natural social collaboration? So I have a feeling, I may not have time to show you the mice data, but I have a feeling that we have stumbled at the basis, neurophysiological basis, that make animals and humans form social groups. It's brain synchronization. So if we're listening to language, like you are in this moment, your brains are resonating at the language of my throat, so you understand English properly. But it doesn't need to be just language. It can be hand gestures. It can be body movements. It can be common goals. We have now reproduced this in mice, in rats, in monkeys, and you won't believe it, but we just did, in humans. This is a patient, one of our new patients, a paraplegic patient on the left, who has a lot of difficulty learning how to walk again because of the lesion, the extent of the lesion. In the right, you have a technician or a physical therapist who, of course, can play the game very easily. So what we're doing to try to speed up the training is to merge the EEG signals coming from the healthy physical therapist and the paralyzed patient, some of which may not be able to communicate if you have a severe degree of paralysis. And we are creating a loop that allows this patient to learn the game faster because the algorithm is mixing 90% of the healthy EEG and 10% of the patient in the beginning and parametrically reduces the contribution of the health subject until the patient can take over. This has started in the same lab in Brazil. We already have three pairs of people. I'm just showing so you see how it is because we are about to publish this, so I cannot show all the data at this moment because the journal would not allow us to publish after that. But basically, I can tell you that it works. The patients collaborate, and it seems that it's much better to have a human than a computer there because there is an effect of having a human being guiding you through this task. Of course, it's like a placebo effect, I think. So I told you in the talk that I would talk about neurological recovery, but also neurological augmentation, and I'm finishing the time, so I can show you that the brain is so plastic. What you saw with the paraplegic patients is an example of how dynamic and how malleable the brain is. You can reroute thoughts to whatever is left to regain function, because that's what the brain is about. It's to keep us alive and to survive and to cope with changes in context in the world. The brain has a point of view. And I may tell you, it's not digital only. It's a mix of analog and digital, and it's recurrent. We're actually publishing articles and now a book where we discussed that Kurt Gödel, Turing, and many other big thinkers had already figured that out, that Kurzweil is wrong. Sorry. He may be here by all that, but I apologize. But he's completely full of that, because it's never going to happen. The human brain has types of information that are not digital only, is analog, is storing the tissue, is storing the synapse. You cannot extract that. That's the reason computers share information. They never share knowledge. Knowledge is created here. And it has been created here for the last 100,000 years, and it cannot be mimicked by an algorithm. Our experiments prove that. I actually don't have time to show you, but there is something to say about plasticity. These are animals, rats, adult rats, that learn to touch otherwise invisible light. I'll repeat. Animals who learn to touch otherwise invisible light. What we did to these guys was to create a prosthetic system that allows them to use their touch cortex, the cortex that is responsible for touch, and rats are very good at that, to detect infrared light in the environment, which mammals cannot see because it's invisible. Okay? Reptiles can, and reptiles can sense, snakes can sense the heat or infrared, but we cannot. So what we did was to place a prosthetic device on the frontal bone that is getting infrared from the environment, generating an electrical output that is delivered directly to the tissue of the somatosensory cortex, creating some sort of somatosensory sensation that we cannot report because we still cannot talk to them. But what you're going to see here is the first time in which these rats, there are four ports, is in the dark. I'm using an infrared camera to show to you. There is an infrared beam that is going to come from one of the four ports, and the animal has to run to it to get water. It's the only way to drink water. And it does. You're going to hear the sound, if we can, of the frequency being delivered, or the electrical stimulation delivered in the somatosensory cortex. So the light comes on. It doesn't matter what it is. It may be in the back. The animal is interpreting as a touch. And as it gets closer to the light, the touch gets better and more pleasant. So the animal tracks the infrared. But this is the somatosensory cortex. That's what the whiskers are represented. So rats use the whiskers to touch objects. But we are basically going over that and basically imposing a new representation because, first of all, if you use only one detector, it takes 40 days to learn. If you use panoramic 360-degree view, it takes basically 4 days. If you, instead of the somatosensory cortex, you go to the visual cortex, which is used to light, not infrared, but light, it takes 30 trials, 1 hour, for these guys to do what you just did. But they can do even more. We create a new task. Oh, by the way, this is the brain of these guys. This is the somatosensory cortex. These neurons on the left are responding to the whiskers, mechanical displacements of the whiskers, as they should. But the same neurons respond to light, infrared light that is coming to the prosthetic device. It's like Geordi's visor, since we spoke about Star Trek, I remember Geordi's eye. Well, these guys, the latest experiment shows that you actually can get a message in the environment, divided half in visible light that the eyes can see, and half in infrared that will go through the prosthetic. They will get together in the visual cortex, and the animals detect and read the message instantaneously. So you're going to see four ports again. One of them, there is nothing, is a control. Another, there is only visible light. And the other, there is only infrared. But in the fourth port, that is changing positions, there is half visual spectrum, half infrared. And it's the merge of the two that the animals have to read to get the message correct. And that's exactly what they do. 5 minutes? I'm marking here. As a good Brazilian, I put a chronometer here. So the four ports, no light, IR distractor, visual distractor, bingo, the two merge. So the animal has to read the port that has both visible infrared coming at the same time. And the cortex, the visual cortex, is actually binding these two signals and getting the animal to respond. And by the way, the reaction time is very similar to what the animal does when it's doing visual. This is after 2 weeks of practicing this task. So basically, we don't even know the limits of the plasticity of our own brain. We heard many years ago, which is preposterous, that we only use 10% of our brains. This is totally absurd. We use everything we have, and some people may need a little more. But what is amazing about the human brain, which for me is the center of the human universe, because it's the brain, the human brain, that creates the reconstruction of everything, our history, the universe history, our political systems, our economic systems, they all come from here. What is amazing is that this device has evolved to adapt to any condition that we impose, so it can create an internal world and represent this world so that we can make it. And I thought I would not have time, so that's the reason I put some of my good friends here to acknowledge, but since I have 3 minutes, I'm going to show you, I swear. I saw it here, 3655, yeah. It's amazing, I never did that in my career. So this is in mice, when you apply the same technique I did in monkeys, you can record in multiple levels, 12 different levels of the brain simultaneously, which gives you a panoramic electrical view that is very unique. Well, we were studying autism using some transgenic mice that you don't care about, but there's a very fundamental issue of autism that is social interaction, a reduction or a lack of ability to socialize. And we see that in some mice. And we stumble in this discovery. This is a normal pair, normal female, normal male, interacting when the female is in estrus, ready to mate. And you're going to see something very beautiful. If the sound is up, we discovered that male mice sing in ultrasound to actually attract the female. And as they sing, they touch with the nose, the whiskers, the female to probably establish a bond, a territory. See? There are syllables, there are songs that we can actually decode, like songbirds, okay? This is a normal, regular, healthy Philadelphia mouse. I live in Philadelphia, so I met many. Now, look at what this transgenic mouse does. It's a model for autism. No singing. And no touching either. Because we discovered that in these mice, there's a hyperconnection, or if you will, a seizure between the touch cortex and the limbic system. Touching for this animal is horrible. It gives a very unpleasant feeling that it doesn't want to experience. So it never or very rarely touches the female, and it does not sing. So when we record the two brains simultaneously of these animals, both pairs that you saw, you are going to understand why I was so excited with the synchronization of the brains of the two monkeys. When the male is singing, making chord to the female, and you're recording both brains, what you see is that the brains synchronize. They synchronize at the same level that you saw in those two monkeys, one watching the other going around to do this game. Now, if you get the transgenic autistic mouse, since he doesn't sing and doesn't touch the female, the brains are out of phase. You never see a bond, a brain bond. So the brain nets that started as just an exercise on multiplying the number of users of a brain-machine interface actually may have helped us to discover what happens and why humans make social groups that are 3 times bigger than our closest relatives, chimpanzees. And social groups is everything. If you think about the history of mankind, is the ability to make social groups, to create social groups, and create a worldview in that social group that defines the evolution of our species. So we may have stumbled trying to understand how brains interact with technology with one fundamental principle of intersocial interaction. And to finish, I just wanted to say exactly that, that I can see the benefits of technology. You just saw some. But I truly believe that the only technology that will help us is the one in which we keep control of it. I don't want my grandchildren to be educated by computers. I want my grandchildren to be educated by human beings. I want my kids playing soccer with their siblings and their neighbors, not with robots. I can see robots going to Fukushima and taking care of the nuclear waste instead of the hundreds of human beings that have to die. But I have to tell you, in Japan, when I went to a meeting to see social robots like we saw here, the old women and lady in the hospital that I visit didn't want those robots. They want human beings with them to the very end. So I think that technology is wonderful if kept under control, because they'll never be us. Sorry. Thank you.